Welcome to the Hindu News Analysis by Shankar IAS Academy for the date 25th May 2019. Displayed are the list of news articles selected for today's analysis and their page numbers in Chennai, Delhi, Bengaluru and Thiruvananthapuram editions of the newspaper. The link for the handwritten notes and the timestamping of the news articles are provided in the description box, and for the benefit of mobile phone viewers, the timestamping is also provided in the comment section. Now let us move on to the first news article. This news article states that this is the right time to carry out an overall assessment of the electoral process. The article has appeared on page number 9 in Thiruvananthapuram edition, 11 in Chennai and Delhi editions, 13, page number 13 in Bangalore edition of the newspaper. The article is relevant in your prelims preparation, in prelims syllabus, in Indian polity and governance, and in mains in powers, functions and responsibilities of various constitutional bodies and important aspect of governance, here electoral governance in this article, and this analysis can also be linked to the salient features of Representation of People Act. Now the author of this editorial article is a former Chief Election Commissioner of India. Now with a positive note, the author has appreciated the three election commissioners and 120 lakh staffs who worked to make this election successful. Now the main highlight of the general elections in 2019, or the elections for the 17th Lok Sabha, was the final voter turnout. Now the final voter turnout of this election, general election 2019, is 67.11%. Now this is the highest voter turnout recorded in the history of Lok Sabha elections. The author states that this proves that the voter education program of the Election Commission of India is effective. This voter education program is called as Systematic Voters Education and Electoral Participation Program, shortly called as SVEEP program. Now this program is the flagship or the most important program of the Election Commission to build a truly participative democracy in India by encouraging all eligible citizens to vote and to make an informed decision during the elections. Now this is done by voter education, spreading voter awareness and by promoting voter literacy in India. The program was started in the year 2009, as it was found by the Election Commission that the final voter turnout at that period stagnated at around 55 to 60%. Now this voter turnout has now improved to 67.11%, and therefore credits are given for the Election Commission's initiative of SVEEP program. However, there remain several questions on the Election Commission for the role played by it in this election. Firstly, the author talks about the length of the election process that started from 11th April 2019 and ended on around 23rd May 2019. The first phase started on 11th April and the seventh phase was conducted on 19th May. And the counting was conducted on 23rd May. Almost 40 days it has taken for the process. Therefore, the author calls it a prolonged process. Now the reason for the prolonged process, or why there were seven phases, was because of security purposes. Now adequate security arrangements have to be put in place primarily for the security of voters and the associated electoral tasks. The most pressing concern for the Election Commission is voter security. For this, personnel from Central Armed Police Forces are required. But their numbers are not enough to conduct the elections in a single day. Therefore, the forces are rotated from one place to another after the conduct of one phase of election, so that there will be enough security arrangements in place in the other place where the next phase is to be held. Then the former Chief Election Commissioner talks about three M's, that is money, media and mafia, and their role in this election. Here money means the money, drugs, narcotics, liquor, precious metals and freebies that were used to bribe the voters. To organize these cash to the electors, or to organize these precious metals, liquors, drugs, narcotics to the electors for bribing, there is a requirement of organized criminals, organized cartels, who the author refers as mafia. And the author also states that the media also played a very important role in this election. The author here listed the top five states with respect to the value of money for the seized money, drugs, narcotics, liquor, precious metals and freebies seized by the election commission. If you look at these top five states, first state is Tamil Nadu, which accounts for around 27% of total money seized by the election commission during this election. This is followed by Gujarat, then Delhi, Punjab and Andhra Pradesh. Now, these five states have accounted for almost 70% of the seized money by the election commission during this election. Now, and the estimation of the seizure by the election commission in the 2019 general elections is around 3,475.76 crores. This amount means it is an increase of 189% of the seized money value of 2014 general elections. The value of seizure in 2014 general elections is 1,200 crore. Now, the money seized shows that high amount of black money has played in this election, and therefore the author says that the problem of black money is alive. Next, the author talks about the role played by the election commission with respect to the violations of model code of conduct. See, model code of conduct is a set of guidelines evolved by the election commission of India to ensure level playing field for all political parties and the candidates contesting in an election. The election commission can take necessary measures against the violators of this model code of conduct. Very recently, you should know that an innovative mobile application named as or called as C-Vigil was launched for citizens to report the violations with respect to model code of conduct and expenditure during the elections. The election commission has taken actions against the violations of the model code of conduct in a delayed manner or casually or carelessly, states the author. For this reason, the election commission has faced criticism in both national level and also in the international level. But the author also acknowledges the difficulty in operationalizing the model code of conduct in the age of social media, particularly in a long and prolonged election where there are many phases of election. Then the author talks about counting. Here, counting refers to counting of votes and counting of VVPAT slips. And it also includes tallying in those VVPAT paper slips in five randomly selected polling stations in each assembly segment of concerned parliamentary constituency. Even here, the election commission proposed the counting of VVPAT verification slips in only one polling station in each assembly segment of a parliamentary constituency to check whether it is tallying with the number of votes polled. But only because of the intervention of Supreme Court, this number was raised to five polling stations in each assembly segment of the particular parliamentary constituency. This was advised by the Supreme Court for better voter confidence and credibility of electoral process, and also to ensure the greatest degree of accuracy and satisfaction. Also, this political parties requested the election commission to carry out counting of VVPAT slips before the counting of votes that are polled in a polling station. And if mismatch was found in that counting, then VVPATs of all polling stations in a parliamentary constituency has to be carried out. This was demanded by the political parties. But the election commission rejected these demands of counting VVPAT slips first before the votes, citing non-feasibility. In all these matters, the election commission should have conducted wider discussions with political parties and should have taken these parties on board with it in the electoral process, states the author. Then the author talks about the interventions by the Supreme Court. He is careful in calling them as interventions, not as interferences. Interference is a negative word, whereas intervention is a positive word. Article 329 of Indian Constitution emphasizes that The courts shall not interfere in electoral matters such as validity of law relating to the delimitation of constituencies or the law relating to the allotment of seats to such delimited constituencies made under Article 327 or 328. The Supreme Court has to intervene for 6 times after the announcement of poll schedule during this 2019 general elections. One of the notable interventions of the court was with respect to the stand taken by the Election Commission that it is toothless and powerless to act on hate speeches. The Supreme Court gave a deadline, and after this rebuke from the Supreme Court, the Election Commission took, according to the author, strong and unprecedented action against some political leaders, debarring them from campaigning for up to 3 days by invoking Article 324 of Indian Constitution. But the author highlights the way the Election Commission acted on the complaints on Prime Minister and the party president of the ruling political party by saying that there are no faults in the actions and speeches of the Prime Minister and the party president of ruling political party. The commission has spoiled its reputation and the fearless independence it commands. The author also notes that the dissenting notes of election commissioners on matters discussed by them should be made public for more transparency. See, the Election Commission consists of a Chief Election Commissioner and 2 Election Commissioners. In the absence of oneness or unity among the 3, then the decisions can be taken by a majority vote. But if one commissioner expresses dissent or difference of opinion, it will not change the result. So the author asks, at least make public the reasons and explanations given by the commissioner who dissented with the other 2 members of the commission in the matters related to the particularly the violations of the model code of conduct. Now finally, the author concludes the article saying that money power, paid news and fake news, communal polarization and hate speeches are serious challenges to the very foundations of our electoral system. And a democracy is only as credible as the strength of the institutions fundamental to its legitimacy. That is, the credibility of a democracy is directly proportional to the strength of the institutions that are fundamental to the legitimacy of the democracy. Here, by institution, he means Election Commission. The Election Commission should be strong in ensuring legitimacy to the electoral process. The author hopes that the newly elected members of Lok Sabha will take necessary reforms and course corrections in all the above issues, whatever we have discussed, to enable the world's largest democracy, our democracy, to become the greatest democracy in the world. Now, the displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Now, let us move on to the next news article. Now, the next news article discusses about the recent change in the standard of reference made for the basic SI unit, that is kilogram, which is the unit for mass. The editorial appears in page number 10 in Chennai and Delhi edition, 12 in Bangalore edition, 8 in Thiruvananthapuram edition of the newspaper. Now, this editorial will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of international importance and also under general science. The author of this editorial discusses about the recent change in the standard of reference made for the basic SI unit, which is kilogram. We have compiled and listed the author's comments in a comparison format for your easy reference. Now, the standard of reference that existed before May 20 is compared with the new reference system. Before 20th May, a physical object was used as a standard of reference for measuring kilogram. It was introduced in 1889, before 130 years. The physical object was a platinum iridium cylinder, which was used to define how much is represented by a mass of 1 kilogram. This cylinder was an alloy cylinder where platinum and iridium were in the ratio of 90:10. Now, after 20th May, a more concrete and better definition of the kilogram has been adopted. Now, this is in terms of a fundamental constant, which is Planck's constant, small h. Earlier, if a mass had to be verified to match with a standard kilogram, it would be placed on one of the pans of a common balance, while the prototype, which is the platinum iridium cylinder, would have to be placed in the other pan. So the mass would be measured against another mass. Now, the very methodology of verification has been altered. A kibble balance is used. Now, this kibble balance balances mass against electromagnetic force in order to measure the mass of an unknown piece. So the very methodology of the verification has been altered. Earlier, the measurement using the platinum iridium cylinder was less precise. Even scientists confirmed that there was a loss of physical weight of this cylinder of up to 50 micrograms. But with the Planck's constant, which is involved in measurement using a kibble balance, the measurement is known precisely. See, all the constants are universal numbers. Here, the value of Planck's constant is 6.626 into 10 power minus 34 kilogram meter square per second. As of May 20, the kilogram has joined a bunch of other SI units, namely the second, meter, ampere, Kelvin, mole, and candela. In the next part of the editorial, the author tells that the history of measurement of the mass has taken a full circle. He tells that the kilogram is now defined once again in terms of universal constants. Now, the author has quoted the timeline of events from a research publication. He tells that originally the definition of mass was in terms of what was then thought of as a universal physical constant. See, in 1791, a universal physical constant, which was presumed that time, was used to measure the mass. Then in 1799, the mass was measured using a physical object and also a presumed universal constant during that time period. Then in 1889, a physical object was used to measure the mass. Now again in 2019, the fundamental physical constant is used to measure the mass. Thus, the author tells it has reached a full circle where once again a physical constant is used in the calculation of mass. Now let us see in detail about different measurements used in those time periods for our knowledge. See, in 1791, a universal physical constant, which was presumed that time, was used to measure the mass. At that time, 1 kilogram was defined as the mass of 1 liter of distilled water at its melting point. Thus, the density of water was the physical constant on which this definition was arrived at. Then we saw in 1799, the mass was measured using a physical object and also a physical constant. So, the kilogram came to be defined using a cylinder of platinum, where for the first time a physical object was used for this purpose. But the mass was also defined as equivalent to the mass of 1 liter of distilled water at atmospheric pressure and at about 4 degrees Celsius. Now this 4 degrees Celsius is the temperature at which water has the maximum density. And then this method was replaced in 1889 when the scientific community adopted the international prototype of the kilogram. The prototype is a cylinder made of an alloy that is 90% platinum and 10% iridium. So the reference to the physical constant, that is mass of 1 liter of water, was abandoned. The author tells that now again we come back full circle and find that the kilogram is defined again in terms of a fundamental physical constant, which is now the Planck's constant. The author finally comments that right now these definitions will look stable, but when the scientists master the art of traveling at relativistic speeds, that is close to the speed of light, then we will have to redefine all these abstract definitions that we have at present to measure various SI units. Now let us see about base SI units, their symbols and the standards of reference that these base SI units have at present. See, kilogram, which is the unit of mass. Its symbol is kg in small letters and its standard of reference is Planck's constant H. For ampere, which is the unit of electric current, the symbol is capital A and its standard of reference is elementary electric charge. For Kelvin, which is the unit of temperature, the symbol is capital K and its standard of reference is Boltzmann constant small k. For mole, which is the unit for amount of substance, the symbol is MOL in small letters and its standard of reference is Avogadro number, Avogadro constant. For second, which is the unit of time, the symbol is small s and its standard of reference is cesium frequency. Now coming to meter, which is the unit for length, the symbol is small m, its standard of reference is speed of the light in vacuum. Then candela, which is the unit for luminous intensity, now the symbol is c small d, the luminous intensity of the monochromatic radiation of frequency is used as the standard of reference for measuring candela. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. Now let us move on to the analysis of next news article. Now this news article is about RBI's proposal to create a liquidity buffer for non-banking financial companies. The article appears in page 15 in Chennai and Delhi edition and 13 in Thiruvananthapuram edition and 17 in Bengaluru edition. Now the analysis of this news article will be relevant in prelim syllabus under current events of national importance and also under economic development. And the analysis will also be relevant to your mains syllabus in GS paper 3 under Indian economy. The Reserve Bank of India has proposed to introduce a liquidity coverage ratio for large non-banking financial companies in order to help in tackling the liquidity issues in the NBFC sector. Now let's see a small background on why RBI is proposing for a liquidity coverage ratio for non-banking financial companies. See, the infrastructure, leasing and financial services, shortly called as IL&FS, is an infrastructure development and finance company that comes under NBFC category. See, on 23rd May, we have discussed about non-banking financial companies in general and also the differences between NBFCs and banks. Now come here, see, the IL&FS company collapsed financially last year. Now this triggered a series of defaults and financial problems such as difficulty in realizing profits, the difficulty in paying back the loans in across the NBFC sector. Know that NBFC sector is also called as shadow banking sector. Now because of the collapse, the borrowing costs for the NBFC sector started to increase. Now this means when an NBFC is in some financial problem, so those who offer loans will offer only at high rates of interest because of the fear that the company is in the situation, particularly in financial problems. Now all these simply means that the NBFCs are in short of money. The money supply is called as liquidity and the shortage in money supply is called as liquidity crisis. Now this liquidity crisis has affected the NBFC sector only at the medium level, but it can affect the overall NBFC sector within a short period, causing a systemic issue. Systemic here refers to the entire financial system. So to contain or manage this liquidity crisis, the Reserve Bank of India has proposed for liquidity coverage ratio. The introduction of this liquidity coverage ratio has been proposed in the draft guidelines on liquidity risk management framework for NBFCs, which also includes core investment companies. See, the main aim of this liquidity coverage ratio is to provide a liquidity buffer to the non-banking financial companies to manage any sort of liquidity crisis. In the newspaper, it is mentioned that the liquidity coverage ratio is proposed for all deposit-taking non-banking financial companies and non-deposit-taking NBFCs with an asset size of 5,000 crore and above. See, it is the LCR is proposed for all non-deposit taking NBFCs with an asset size of 5,000 crore and above and for all deposit taking NBFCs irrespective of their asset size. Now, to know the difference, see, deposit taking NBFCs means they can perform lending and also take deposits. But the non-deposit taking NBFCs means they can perform only the lending activity. They cannot take deposits. They generally depend on banks for taking the deposits. Now let's come back to our discussion. See, this liquidity coverage ratio will be implemented in a phased and a calibrated manner over 4 years starting from April 2020. A minimum LCR, a minimum liquidity coverage ratio of 60% has to be maintained by NBFCs by April 2020. Within 4 years, that is by 2024, the LCR has to be increased to 100%. Now, in this context, let us see about how liquidity coverage ratio is calculated. Liquidity coverage ratio is represented by the ratio of stock of high quality liquid assets to the total net cash outflows over the next 30 calendar days. Now, let's see what is meant by high quality liquid assets. See, it is the liquid assets that can be readily sold or immediately converted into cash at little or no loss of value. These assets can also be used as a collateral to obtain funds when there is a liquidity stress. Now, collateral means something that can be pledged as security for repayment of a loan. So the ultimate aim of RBI is to make this stock of high quality liquid assets equivalent to the total net cash outflows over the next 30 calendar days. Net cash outflows is nothing but a non-banking financial company's cash balance, which is the difference between cash inflows and outflows in a given period. So this liquidity buffer should be aimed toward 100% by 2024. There are many complexities in calculating the total net cash outflows of a non-banking financial companies. So the purpose of this liquidity coverage ratio is to prevent the NBFCs from potential liquidity disruptions or disturbances that are likely to affect the running of NBFCs because of the shortage of the liquid financial assets. So the NBFCs has to ensure to have sufficient high quality liquid assets in order to survive any serious or acute liquidity stress scenario that may last for 30 days. The ultimate aim of RBI is to maintain a stock of high quality liquid assets to a minimum of 100% of the total net cash outflows over the next 30 calendar days. This 100% is being planned to be achieved by the year 2024 as per the draft guidelines proposal of Reserve Bank of India. Now, know that liquidity coverage ratio exists for the banking sector since 2015. The LCR was implemented and measured in 2011, but the 100% minimum was enforced only in 2015. That is, LCR was implemented and measured in 2011, but 100% minimum was not enforced until 2015. So the 100% minimum became binding on banks only from 2015. Now, the displayed practice prelims question will be discussed in the final session. Now, let us take our analysis to the next news article. Now, the next news article is about higher education policy. See, this article appears in page number 9 in Chennai and Delhi editions and 11 in Bengaluru edition and 7 in Thiruvananthapuram edition. It will be relevant in prelims syllabus under current events of national importance and in public policy. And in mains, it will be relevant in GS2 in government policies and interventions for development in various sectors in education. And also in issues relating to development and management of education. Now, the news article discusses about the proposed new initiative by the government. Now, here the Ministry of Human Resource Development is planning to launch an ambitious action plan to improve the quality and accessibility of higher education in India. Now, this plan was named as EQUIP, which is the acronym for Education Quality Upgradation and Inclusion Program. Now, the article states that this plan is described as the implementation plan for new national education policy. The policy was promised by 2014 to 2019 NDA government and was not implemented even after 5 years of repeated delays and extensions. But a draft national education policy 2016 was released, and the article states that the new national education policy is likely to be released in as soon as possible, in a week, it says. See, we already have national education policy of 1986 and a revision of the same policy in the year 1992. Now, you note that recently on 18th May, we saw about Acharya Ramamurthy committee that was set up to review the national education policy of 1996. That day, we discussed about the committee's, particularly the Acharya Ramamurthy committee's view or recommendations on neighborhood schools. And we also discussed why common school system did not gain popular and complete acceptance in India, or why it could not gain ground in India. Now let us see about this new plan EQIP. See, it is an acronym for Education Quality Upgradation and Inclusion Program. Now, it is the this plan is the central government's endeavor towards transforming the higher education system of India. Now, it is expected that it will be carried out by implementing strategic interventions in the sector for a period of 5 years, from 2019 to 2024. And the plan will be implemented with the vision to achieve quality, inclusivity, and excellence in higher education, and to empower the institutions of higher education so as to contribute in a great way towards fueling the progress of the nation. Now, this plan was devised to give a multi-pronged boost to the higher education system in India. We read some statement that has, you know, multi-pronged. Here, multi-pronged means having several distinct aspects or various elements. So, this plan is having different aspects or that can give a great boost to the Indian higher education system. Now, so as to make the higher education institutions in India to be ranked among the global best institutions, and to make the higher education system to be ranked among the global best systems also. And the plan also aims to bring a transformational change in the higher education system over next 5 years. Now, coming to the objectives, now the proposed objectives are to double the gross enrollment ratio in higher education and to resolve the geographically skewed or geographically distorted or the geographically biased access to higher education institutions, and also to achieve globally acceptable quality standards across the country. That means the quality standards of the higher education systems in India should be, you know, matching the international standards of higher education system, and to position at least 20 Indian institutions among the top global institutions, and also to promote research and innovation ecosystem in higher education, and to substantially improve employability of the students, and to promote a necessary framework for internationalization. Now, this will result in better accreditation or better recognition of Indian higher education system at the international level. The plan also aims to carry out necessary governance reforms and also promoting the increase in investments in higher education system. Now, the Department of Higher Education and the Ministry of Human Resource Development has constituted 10 expert groups to design and formulate this plan. And they will finalize the strategies, and they will identify initiatives and also provide necessary estimate for investments that are required in this higher education system, and will finalize also the timelines for the implementation of various interventions. And now let us move on to the next news article. This news article is about banning a terror outfit which is based in Bangladesh. The news article appears in page 9 in Chennai Delhi edition, 11 in Bengaluru edition, and 7 in Thiruvananthapuram edition. Now, this news article will be relevant in prelims under current events of national importance, Indian polity and governance and public policy, GS paper 3 under role of external state and non-state actors in creating challenges to internal security, and also under security challenges and their management in border areas, linkages of organized crime with terrorism. Here, terrorist organizations and terrorists are the non-state actors who create challenges to the internal security of India. Now, the news is that under the anti-terror law, the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act, the central government has banned this terror outfit which is based in Bangladesh, named as, that is, Jamaat-ul-Mujahideen Bangladesh. And this terror outfit was allegedly involved in the 2016 terror attacks at a cafe in Bangladesh's capital city, Dhaka. Now, this organization was declared as an unlawful association by the Ministry of Home Affairs on 24 May 2019. A notification has been issued by the Ministry of Home Affairs, which say that the outfit was planning to set up permanent bases within 10 kilometer area along the Bangladesh border in several districts of West Bengal, Assam and Tripura. And in addition, the notification also stated that the group of this terror outfit planned to spread its network in South India with an ultimate motive to establish a caliphate in the Indian subcontinent. Now, we saw that this Bangladesh-based terror outfit was banned under the anti-terror law named as the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act of 1967. Now, this act is valid for entire India, including the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, the provisions of this act apply also to citizens of India who reside outside India and to persons who are in the service of government and wherever they may be. And finally, to persons working on ships and aircrafts that are registered in India and they may be wherever and the law is applicable to them. Now, there are three things. First, now, unlawful activity is any action of an individual or an association that intends to bring cession or secession of a part of the Indian territory from the Indian Union. Here, cession means the formal giving up of rights, property or territory by a state. Here, state is India. And secession means the act of withdrawing formally from a state. Now, secession also means separatist tendency. Sometimes they say separatist tendency as secessionist tendency. So, both these acts are considered as unlawful activities as per the provisions of this legislation. Next, if an action of an individual or an association intends to disrupt the sovereignty and integrity of India, then it is also considered as an unlawful activity. Also, if an action of an individual or an association intends to cause disaffection or dissatisfaction against India, then that is also considered as an unlawful activity. Now, let us know about unlawful association. See, if any association which encourages or aids the persons to undertake any unlawful activity, or even if the members of the association involve in any unlawful activity, then they are classified as unlawful association. Either the association or the members of the association involving in unlawful activity, they are classified as, the association will be classified as unlawful association. Now, an association can also be declared as unlawful association under Indian Penal Code also by Section 153A of IPC. If the association encourages or aids persons, or even if the members of the association promote enmity between different groups of India. That is, if it encourages in promotion of enmity between different groups, or aids those persons who promote enmity, or if the members of the particular association promotes enmity between different groups of India, then the association can be declared as an unlawful association under Section 153A of Indian Penal Code. Now, this section deals with the offense of promoting enmity between different groups on grounds of religion, race, place of birth, residence, language, etc. and doing acts that are against the maintenance of harmony in India. Now, let's see about this unlawful activities tribunal under this legislation. See, this tribunal can be constituted by the central government as and when it considers necessary to form such a tribunal. This tribunal has only member as per the provisions of the act, and the central government cannot appoint any other person other than a judge of a high court as a member of this tribunal. So we just saw about what is unlawful activity, what is unlawful association, then we saw about unlawful activities tribunal. So under the provisions of this law, whenever the center notifies any association involving in unlawful activities as a unlawful association, the notification shall specify the grounds or reasons on which the notification is issued. So, if you would have seen in this news article that the Bangladesh-based terror outfit is planning to construct permanent camps, and other reasons are stated. Now, these are the reasons mentioned by the center while banning this terror outfit as an unlawful association. So once it notifies, see, within 30 days of publishing this notification in the official gazette, it has to refer this notification to Unlawful Activities Tribunal. Next, this tribunal shall issue a show cause notice to the banned unlawful association. Now, this association has to reply within 30 days of receiving the show cause notice from the tribunal on the subject why the particular association should not be declared as an unlawful association in India. Now, after receiving the reply from this association, the tribunal has to decide on the notification within 6 months from the date of the issuing of the notification. So these are the basic stuff from the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act of 1967. The displayed prelims question will be discussed in the last session. And with this, we come to the end of discussion of the news articles. Next, let us go on to the practice cum revision session or the prelims questions discussion session. Now, the first question has two statements, and they are asking which of the statements are correct. The first statement, the election for the 17th Lok Sabha witnessed the highest voter turnout in the history of elections to the Lok Sabha. Now, this statement is correct, and 17th Lok Sabha is the recent general elections 2019. Was the Lok Sabha elections for 17th Lok Sabha, and this the voter turnout in this election is the highest turnout recorded ever in general elections, or in other way, in the for the elections to the Lok Sabha. And this time the voter turnout was 67.11%. Therefore, the first statement is correct. The second statement, systematic voters education and electoral participation program is a flagship initiative of Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, and it aims to build a truly participative democracy in India by encouraging all eligible citizens to vote and to make an informed decision during the elections. Now, this statement appears to be correct, but the initiative is not the initiative of Ministry of Information and Broadcasting. Rather, it is the flagship initiative of Election Commission of India, started in the year 2009. One of the reasons is to also to improve the voter turnout. In the year 2009, when it was when the program was started, it was felt that the voter turnout was stagnating around some 55 to 60%. Now it has almost increased from that level to 67.11 in the recent election. Today's editorial was giving credit to this particular program of Election Commission of India. So the second statement is wrong, as it is the program of Election Commission, not in Ministry of Information and Broadcasting. So the answer for this question is option A, one only. Now, the second question, they have given SI base units and their standards of reference, and they are asking to choose the correct pair. Now, if you see the first pair, they are given Kelvin. Kelvin is the unit of temperature. And for Kelvin, the Boltzmann constant is used as the standard of reference. So the first pair is correctly matched. Now, the second, kilogram, which is the unit of mass, They are saying it is standard of reference is platinum iridium cylinder. Now, before 20th May, it could be the correct answer, but now it is not so, because platinum iridium cylinder is a physical object which was replaced with Planck's constant, which is now used as the standard of reference for measuring kilogram. So, in order to make this pair a correct pair, the standard of reference for kilogram should have been Planck's constant. So the second pair is incorrectly matched. Now the third pair, C, mole, is the unit for amount of substance, and the standard of reference for that is Avogadro constant. So that is correctly matched. So the correct pair is 1 and 3. So option C is the correct answer. Now the third question, this question is with respect to liquidity coverage ratio. They have given two statements and are asking which of the statements are correct. Now, the first statement says liquidity coverage ratio is the ratio of high quality liquid assets that a bank or a non-banking financial company has to maintain so that it can be converted into cash in case of liquidity stress. Now, this is actually the definition of liquidity coverage ratio, and therefore the first statement is correct. Now, the second statement, liquidity coverage ratio can be decided by each individual bank or a non-banking financial company. Now, this statement is wrong. See, only the Reserve Bank of India, which is the regulator here, mandates or fixes the liquidity coverage ratio for both banks and non-banking financial companies. Now, this ratio fixed by RBI is common for all the banks and common for within the non-banking financial companies. So, the question asks for the correct statement. So, option A, one only, is the correct answer for this question. Now, the next question is with respect to the Unlawful Activities Prevention Act 1967. They have given again two statements asking which of the statements are correct. Now, the first statement, this legislation was enacted in Indian Parliament for effective prevention of certain unlawful activities of individuals and associations and related matters. The point is very straightforward and the statement is correct, and that is the purpose of the legislation. The second statement, this act is not applicable in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. Now, this statement is wrong because we saw this legislation is applicable in the state of Jammu and Kashmir also. We see many legislations not applicable in the state of Jammu and Kashmir because of the special provision for Jammu and Kashmir. But this legislation is an exemption, and this legislation applies even in the state of Jammu and Kashmir. So the second statement here given is wrong. So the answer for this question is option A, one only. With this, we come to the end of today's The Hindu News Analysis. If you like the video, press the like button, share, comment, and subscribe to Shankar IAS Academy YouTube channel for more updates and content on daily news analysis.